Very good morning to all. As per today's schedule, sorry for the delay, as our expert who is scheduled for this session, because of some reason, he was not available over there. So I'm starting with this session of the case studies, which we having different types of case studies regarding repair and rehabilitation of buildings, bridges, and there are lots of industries problem which we have sorted out. So starting with this, and before starting with that, I just want to tell you that we are going to validation of this entire session at around after this, just after this my session over here. So starting with this, we having various case studies. So this first case studies which I'm going to discuss with you is a case study of military station Udhampur. So coming to what was the building and what is that, there is a building of military station in Udhampur, that is in J&K. This building was around 32 to 35 years old. The detailed visual inspection was carried out to scrutinize the type, extent and source of damage. An investigation was carried out to check the concrete quality, corrosion in the reinforcing bars, carbonation of the concrete and ingress of salts in the concrete. The concrete quality was found out by using ultrasonic pulse velocity and rebound hammer method. These non-destructive tests I have explained in my previous lecture in detail. So that was the base of all these NDTs, and today I'm going to discuss how we have used these NDT methods over the site. The carbonation depth was determined by using the phenolphthalein test, that is the rainbow indicator name of the chemical. So here you can see there is a it's a plan of that particular building which we have tested and suggested the repair and rehabilitation method. So here if you can see there, we have written over there, there is a two colors in which we have defined the whole columns. The first is orange color, that is column with required full length repair, that is very critical, whose condition was very critical. And second is yellow color, that shows, which denotes column which required repair up to second floor only. The building was G+2. It was a G+2 building. So if we go over there, you can see this is the entire plan over there. And the colors which I have mentioned is only of the outer columns, because the direct influence of the environment was majorly affected on the outer columns of this building. So what were the outcomes of the visual inspection? The first one is, it was observed that the exterior columns of the building have vertical cracks and spalling at some of the locations. Then dampness and efflorescence on the walls, as also observed, especially at the lower level of the building. Some minor cracks along the opening of the window and doors. Damaged staircase of servant quarter entrance from the backyard of the building. Spalling of concrete and exposed corroded reinforcement in exterior columns of both the buildings. Termite attack on the ground floor and first floor of the building. These were some of the basic visual inspection which we have taken out. Then backside staircase along with the servant quarter of the building is completely damaged. Brick tiles on the terrace of the building are damaged, which leads to the ingress of water through them. Plantation growth on the terrace of the building and the rainwater pipes are damaged. So these are the visual inspection which we have on the basis of, we have decided what kind of testing we are going to conduct, what repair methodology we are going to suggest. Now, if we talk in a broad sense, visual inspection, we categorize visual inspection in various terms. It is like visual inspection of RCC building. As I have told you, that one is a RCC building only. First is efflorescence. And we all know what is efflorescence. Efflorescence caused due to the, it is a chemical reaction. If there is a salts presents in your bricks or in any building material, or in any, if it is salts presents in water also, then it appears a white color of efflorescence over your building. Then permeable and unsound concrete. If the concrete is permeable and unsound, that water can easily gets into this concrete, it will directly affect its quality and its strength. Cracks and gradual disintegration of concrete. There are some cracks and gradually the concrete is getting disintegrated. And chalky surface around the aggregate particles. Then reveling of disintegration of concrete, reveling and disintegration of concrete. Then cracking and spalling of concrete. So there are some other things which are correlated to these, all these parameters. The first one, which is, you can see over here, that all these are the processes which are interlinked with each other. There is a proper relationship. So first is efflorescence. It is related to leaching, that water containing carbonic acid leaches out of the calcium hydroxide developed by the hydration of Portland cement, and that is a chemical process. Then second is permeable or unsound concrete. If it is a permeable or unsound concrete, then non-acidic reaction between the calcium components of hardened cement paste and components of aggressive liquids gets into it, and that is also a chemical process. Then cracks and gradual disintegration of concrete happens over there. Then it is majorly affected with sulfate attack. Same with alkali aggregate reaction. And from both of these, the reaction accompanied by excessive expansion. If there is excessive expansion, the concrete, there is a extra internal stresses developed over there. And because of this internal stresses, the concrete starts, the disintegration of the concrete will starts, which is also a chemical process. So reveling and disintegration leads to the reaction of hardened paste with acidic water. If the concrete is in contact with some acidic water, then this type of disintegration happens. And if it is a spalling of concrete, then crystallization of penetrated salt solution generated excessive pressure. That is a physical process. Then cracking, which may be because of shrinkage and unequal thermal expansion, and that is a mechanical action. Then rust staining, cracking, delamination, and spalling, which leads to the corrosion of steel. And you know, that is an electrochemical process, and that electrochemical process also is a chemical process. So this is the whole scenario, how each and everything is related to each other, and that chemical process majorly, because the building is affected with the chemical processes mostly. And most of the cases, we are not taking care of all these things. Generally, whenever we visited a site, we never see that they have done the chemical testing of aggregates, what they are using. Like they have not tested the chemical composition, like your sulfates and chlorides in this sand over there or not. So on the behalf of visual inspection, you can see there are two pictures. One is the spalling of concrete over there, and second, after spalling, you can see there is a corrosion in steel. The steel is corroded, and because of this corrosion of steel, the diameter of area of your steel expands, and because of this expansion, there arises a internal stresses in concrete, and due to which initially the crack was there, and then this complete happens. Then you can see there is a cracks in column at the bottom level, which is just near to the ground level. And second, you can see there is a vertical crack. There is a vertical crack of a building, which eventually leads to this spalling. This is the initial condition. This is, you can see there is an initial condition over there that cracks has been developed. And if it is not treated over there, or if it is not taken care at this period of time, it will lead to the further deterioration of this building. Now you can see there is a damaged staircase, and that damaged staircase is also because of this chemical reaction. As you can see, the reinforcement is completely exposed, because the reinforcement is completely exposed and your steel is getting rusted. So this concrete strength, compressive strength as well as tensile strength, is affecting because of this. So coming to non-destructive testing, after all these things we have taken care of, on behalf of visual inspection, we have decided some tests further we have to conduct. The first one is the number of non-destructive and partially destructive techniques for the assessment of the concrete structure and also to predict the cause of deterioration of the existing structures are available. In the overall world, the interest of the non-destructive testing increasing day by day. These NDT techniques can be broadly classified into four groups, like strength test, durability test, performance test, and integrity test and chemical test. With the help of these tests, we can find out in situ strength quality of the concrete to precise identify the damage and cause of the deterioration of the structure. So what test we have conducted, it is shown over there. The NDT, under NDT, the first is Schmidt hammer test, as which is also known as rebound hammer test. As I have already discussed all these tests in detail in my previous lecture. Then second is the ultrasonic pulse velocity test. Third is carbonation test and concrete resistivity test. These are the tests for the concrete. And then reinforcement scanning test is also conducted so that we can check what is the condition of the reinforcement, what is the dia of the reinforcement, what is the cover of the reinforcement. Because ultimately, the cover is going to be affected on the durability of the concrete. If the cover is proper, then our steel, which is embedded inside your concrete, is safe as compared to the if the cover is less. Then we have conducted taken some samples. All these tests which I have mentioned till now, these are the tests which are conducted at site only. And there are some chloride and sulfate ingress test, that is a chemical testing, which we have taken some samples from that building, and which were taken to our lab, and then the chloride and sulfate ingress testing was done. Now, if we talk about the Schmidt hammer test, what is Schmidt hammer test? I have already explained about all these things, but I wish so that I can again tell you, or you can call it a brush up over there. This is the fastest method to evaluate the quality of concrete based on hardness, which is indicated by rebound number. I have tell you that whenever we use the rebound hammer, it gives a rebound number, not directly compressive strength. On behalf of rebound number, there is a relation of compressive strength of every rebound hammer. If the strength of concrete is high, the rebound hammer number is also high, which is very clear. The principle of this test is that when the plunger of rebound is pressed against the surface of the concrete, the spring-controlled mass rebound and the extent of such rebound depends upon the surface hardness of the concrete, which means that the concrete is more the concrete is hard, the higher the rebound value, or you can call it higher the rebound number we will get. But there is a relationship of hardness with compressive strength of concrete. So on behalf of this hardness, we can define that what is the grade of that particular concrete. The surface hardness of the concrete and therefore the rebound number is taken to be related to the compressive strength of the concrete. In the latest rebound hammer, there is no need of angle correction. There is no need of angle correction, as I have discussed you earlier that there is no need of angle correction because we are using digital rebound hammer, which is capable of taking care of this angle correction. Now, Schmidt hammer test, you can see this is the digital rebound hammer which we have used, which are using, that is the N-type rebound hammer. The make is Prosec, and it is a N-type rebound hammer, and as we know that N-type rebound hammer is used for the concrete whose maximum aggregate size is up to 20 mm, or the maximum is 25. If the maximum aggregate size is above 25 mm, then we can use P-type rebound hammer. So there is an average rebound number. If it is a greater than, we can broadly classify the quality of concrete on the basis of this rebound number also, apart from the compressive strength. If the value is getting greater than 40, then it is a very good hard layer. If we are getting 30 to 40, that is a good layer. If it is 20 to 30, that is a fair. And it is less than 20, that is a poor concrete. Or if it is coming less than 10, it is in between 0 to 10, or it is delaminated. So quality of concrete cover on behalf of, by using this rebound number, we can also tell the quality of a concrete cover. Now coming to the ultrasonic pulse velocity test. Ultrasonic pulse velocity test, which is broadly named as UPV test. This method is generally used for the measurement of concrete quality, determination of cracking and honeycombing, and assessment of concrete deterioration. The principle of these tests involves sending electroacoustic pulse through a concrete path and measuring the transit time taken for a known distance, because the value which we are getting is in meter per second, that is the velocity, and velocity is taken out by distance upon time, and there is a particular distance which we have to enter, and we have to see what time it is taking. So both the values what we are getting, on behalf of that we will evaluate the concrete quality. The ultrasonic pulse velocity depends mainly on the elastic modulus of the concrete. So there is a as per the code IS 13311 part 1, the velocity relation of velocity and concrete quality is given over there. If it is greater than 4 km per second, then it is very good and excellent. 3.5 to 4, it is very good. Slightly porosity may exist. 3 to 3.5, satisfactory, but loss of integrity is suspected. And 3 is the poor. Below 3, it is poor and loss of integrity exists. Now, coming to carbonation test. Concrete having micropores, and these pores are filled with liquid, which having pH values as high as 12.5, as I have already discussed in my previous lecture, that the concrete is highly alkaline in nature and its pH is around 12.5. Thus, the concrete is highly alkaline in nature. Then carbonation of the concrete is the reaction of CaOH2 with atmospheric carbon dioxide and its conversion into CaCO3. This reaction decreases the pH value of the pore water to about 8.5 or maybe less than that. The outer zone of the concrete is affected first due to the passage of time. Carbonation proceeds deeper into the mass of CO2 diffused inward from the surface. If the carbonation depth equal to the steel of the concrete, then steel prone to the corrosion damage. By this test, we measure the carbonation depth of the concrete. To determine the path of the carbonation, drilling of a hole is done in stages and the phenolphthalein solution sprayed over it after every stage. As soon as the color of the concrete becomes pink, stop drilling and the depth of the hole measured. That is the way how you can find out what is the depth of the concrete. Or there is another way which we have discussed. We have to take the core from that particular concrete, and that core which we have taken is sprayed by using phenolphthalein indicator. That is the commercial name is rainbow indicator. And that rainbow indicator will tell you what is the pH of concrete and what is the pH of concrete which have been ingressed into that particular concrete. So by carbonation test, we measure the carbonation depth of the concrete. Concrete is alkaline in nature. The pH of value of the concrete at the time of construction is around 12.5. During the course of time, carbon dioxide from the external environment enters into the concrete. So you can see there is a pH meter which is mentioned over there. And on this behalf of this color, we have mentioned some values over there from 5, 7, 9, 11 up to 13. So if the concrete which is very new and which is not affected with the carbonation, then the color which you are getting is 13. And eventually it starts decreasing toward the reddish side, that is your orange, or it may come to the reddish side. Now, carbonation test on core sample. You can see we have taken the core, and you can see there is a that concrete is carbonated, and we are measuring the concrete's carbonation depth over there. And this is another sample. The first one sample is hits which pH we have discussed earlier, that the first one's pH is around 10 to 11, which is not that much affected with pH. But the second image, you can see the core is completely carbonated and it's showing the color of reddish color over there. So this is the rainbow indicator. This is the spray which we are using for this carbonation testing. Now, we are clear with the carbonation test, which we have conducted. Now, coming to the reinforcement scanning test, ferro scanner is a device used to locating reinforcing bars and estimate the diameter and depth of the cover. This device is based on interaction between the bars and low frequency electromagnetic fields. The physical principle that is employed in the electromagnetic induction, whereby the alternating magnetic field induces the electrical potential, is an electrical circle intersected by the field. The test of the reinforcement scan is done with the help of Hilti PS200 ferro scan as portable system for detecting rebar in a concrete structures. That instrument which we have used is Hilti PS200, which this instrument is real-time image it can show and evaluate the reinforcement mesh, and it gives a it records the whole scenario, and what it gives us the result in a form of data, which then recorded data is transferred to the monitor and further analysis at the site itself. The major analysis and conclusion is done on the computer on the analysis software to produce report of the data recorded, which is further submitted to the structural consultant for the preparation of the structural drawings, and thereby establishing the stability of the structure. The limitation of these tests are interferences may occur in image due to scrap of reinforcement in concrete, tie wires, and rebar cross aggregates with ferromagnetic properties. The limitation of this aggregate, this ferroscanning, is that if there is some ferrous material inside your concrete, then it will show some other some distorted results over there. So this is the instrument which I'm discussing. The first one, which is PS200 scanner. This is the instrument used for the scanning, and PS200 monitor. And after scanning, the data is transferred to this monitor, and you can see the whole grid is formed over there, and 600 by 600 mm data sheet is scanned, and you got the location over there. Now, surface resistivity meter provides very useful information about the surface of the concrete. There is a new test which I'm going to discuss, is concrete resistivity test. It is not only it not only provide the corrosion information, but also provide the correlation between the resistivity and chloride diffusion rate. The operating principle of the Wenner probe and reciprocal is designed to measure the electrical resistivity of the concrete or rock. A current is applied to two outer probes, and the potential difference is measured between the two inner probes. The current is carried by ions in the pore liquid. The calculated resistivity depends on the spacing of the probes. Resistivity rho, that is 2 pi a v upon l, that is, it comes in kilo ohm centimeter. So this is the resistivity meter, and on behalf of this resistivity meter, we got some values. If we having the values greater than 100 kilo ohms centimeter, then the risk of corrosion is negligible. If the value is coming between 50 to 100, then low risk of corrosion. If it is 10 to 50, that is a moderate risk of corrosion. And if it is less than 10, then that is a high risk of corrosion. So by using this concrete resistivity test, we can tell is that concrete is prone to corrosion or not. What is the risk of corrosion over the concrete? So this is the principle on which it works. There are four probes. You can see there are two outer probes and two inner probes. This is the concrete resistivity meter. Now, these all tests which I have discussed till now are the tests which were conducted on the site only. And now there is a chloride and sulfate ingress test, that is a test conducted on the samples collected from the particular site and taken to the lab, and the tests were conducted at our laboratory. Quantity of the chlorides and sulfate in the concrete is generally determined chemically. Sulfate and chloride contents of the concrete samples collected from various locations were found out. The permissible limit of chloride content by weight of cement is 0.4%, and 0.15% is enough for onset of the corrosion. So these are the limits of the chloride contents into a concrete. If your value of the these percentage are increasing, the risk of various chemical process, which we have discussed earlier, is also increasing. So sulfate contents are limited to 4% by weight of cement. So these are the limits on behalf of we can evaluate the concrete salt ingress. If the test results and interpretation like required cover thickness and good quality, that is a non-corrosion prone. If we are providing a very good cover thickness and good quality so that nothing is going to ingress into your concrete, then it is a non-corrosion prone. Then required cover thickness and bad quality of concrete, then it is a corrosion prone, and very less cover thickness yet good quality cover concrete, that is also a concrete corrosion prone. So in short, we can sum up like this, that the cover thickness and good quality concrete is the requirement so that your concrete is not a corrosion prone. So here is the test of the NDT analysis. You can see there is a first serial number, and that the location of the columns which we have given, and the very second slide which I have shown, that in graph we have in the plan of that building, we have mentioned these columns C1, C2, C3. And on behalf of that, we have taken some rebound number. For example, if we take the value of serial number 3, you can see there is a C3 is the name of the column. And we are getting values 18, 28.5, 24, 16.5, 24.5, and 26. Here we have taken the values which are after the standard deviation, and average rebound hammer value is 26.3. We have taken around 10 readings, and the extreme higher value and extreme lower value are discarded. And you can see there is the average UPV value is 2073. So it lies in the category of poor, because as per IS 13311 part 1, which says the values which is less than 3000 comes in the category of poor. And compressive strength is only 10. You can see that 10. And at the design of time, the building which was constructed was at least, because at the time the nominal mix was used, because as I already told you in the starting of this lecture, that this building was around 30 to 35 years old. And if we take as a nominal mix, they have used at least M20 grade at that time. So that concrete strength is decreased over there. Compressive strength after correction of carbonation, because we have taken the carbonation factor also, that it is a 8 to 9, in between 8 to 9 carbonation was there. So we have taken the carbonation factor and the compressive strength is 9. So these are the tests which we have conducted. You can see there are 16 points which we have taken. 16 columns have been taken. Now this is the result of concrete resistivity. We have discussed what is the effect of concrete resistivity. If the value comes lower, the concrete is more prone to corrosion. So we have getting the value of 38.84, that is moderately prone to concrete. Then there is a value of 15, 22, 37, 38, 19, 22, and so on. So it shows that the concrete is getting prone to corrosion gradually. This is the other results. We have taken 16 columns, and we have taken the 16 columns of for the concrete resistivity test also. Now, we have taken 6 samples from there to check the chloride and sulfate ingress. And eventually, you can see that after getting the results, these are less than. But as we have told you, that if it is the value is 0.15, greater than 0.15 for the chloride, it is sufficient for the onset of the corrosion. The permissible limit is higher, but it is sufficient for the corrosion initiation of the corrosion process. And sulfates, that is the 4% by weight, and you can see it is the 3.6, 3.2, 2.9. So that is under permissible limit, but eventually that will have some effect also. So that's why we have taken, if we look at the previous slide over there, the carbonation and pH is in between 8 and 9. That is not that much decreased, but it will further decrease if no care is taken over there. Now, coming to repair of the structure, these, after all these, we have get what are the results, what is the present condition over there, and behalf of that, now, summary of the problem and defect. First problem is crack. We have taken out the summary over there. First is cracks. We've seen through that there are major throughout cracks over the columns, which is mostly on the outer columns, and minor cracks near opening of windows and doors in the most of the locations. Then rusting of bar. The corrosion was observed at few locations due to spalling of concrete or carbonation of the concrete. Then that is spalling of concrete, because if rusting of bar is there, then that is followed by spalling of concrete. Spalling of concrete is observed in some of the locations, such as outer columns of the buildings. Dampness and efflorescence. Dampness and efflorescence has been observed in most of the houses, especially at the ground level, near sunken area and near staircase area, because this dampness is because of the rising capillary action from the adjoining soil surface and ground water. Then railing, the present railing is damaged and need to be replaced. So these are the major sum up which I have summarized in the problems and defects. So recommendation, what are the recommendation which we have given to them, is the strengthening of outer column of the building is to be done with jacketing with micro concrete. Reinforcement is to be provided where steel is rusted more than 20%. You have to check the diameter of the steel, but for that you have to take care of what is the exact diameter. For that you have to remove the rust by using some chemical, which I'm going to tell, and what we have suggested is shown over there. All the traps and manholes should be repaired to prevent the seepage into the foundation from such location, because with the passage of time, these manholes and traps need to be repaired and rehabilitated so that water will not seep into the foundation and adjoining soils, and it will not get rises as by the capillary action into the walls and columns of the structure. Water tanks on the roof are causing dampness due to overflow of water or due to leakage. All the tanks should be repaired and overflow should be stopped by providing suitable float valve. Exposed concrete was found to be carbonated. The carbonated concrete should be provided with anti-carbonation coating if the spalling of cover concrete has not started. If the spalling of cover concrete is taking place, the same should be repaired by treating the affected reinforcement and repairing cover with micro concrete. So it is like this: repair of spalling concrete of outer columns. The first is support, providing support, scaffolding, and surface preparation. The first method is the first step. If we are telling you how we can repair the structure, the first is support, scaffolding, and surface preparation. Second is corrosion protection to the existing reinforcement. For that, we have to first remove the rust over there by using rust off 100, and then applying the corrosion protection chemical over there. Then fixing and grouting of new reinforcement. We have to fix new reinforcement if your steel is rusted more than 20%. Then epoxy bonding primer is there, because the bond between old and new concrete will not form until you have not provided any bonding agent. So here we are suggested to use the epoxy bonding primer for the jacketing purpose. And finally, the jacketing with micro concrete. Now, repair of spalling, in detail, the providing and erecting steel props up to full height, braced at center, resting on wedge and block to support the structure provisionally during repair work, and maintaining them in position till required as directed by the engineer in charge. Because if we are going for the repair and rehabilitation, first we have to ensure all the safety measures have been taken. Then chipping of unsound weak concrete up to cover of reinforcement over slab column, if that is, and wall, or as per the site requirement, by chiseling maximum up to 30 mm depth, and disposal of mulba from site as per the site inspection of the engineer in charge. Then, now coming to the second step is your apply of rust remover cum passivator to remove rust from the existing reinforcement. Here, what product we have used is mentioned over here, that is the Sika rust of 100, and it is the consumption and density is written over here. Then after the removal of this rust removal, the second step is applying a cement-based polymer-modified rebar corrosion protection system to existing reinforcement. The product which we have used is Sika Top Armtech 108. The product requirement is carbonation resistance 2 mm Sika Top Armtech 108 corresponds to 20 mm of normal mortar, bond strength 1 Newton, which is it is as per ASTMC 882 and 78. Then after this correction protection and all corrosion protection and all that, we have to check, is your steel is sufficient or not? If it is not sufficient, like it is corroded more than 20%, then we have to provide new reinforcement and we have to fix some new reinforcement. Providing extra reinforcement with TMT bar as per the site design or requirement, including straightening, cutting, bending, placing in position, binding with GI wire of 18 gauge, etc. Additional reinforcement with adequate lap length and ring at required spacing shall be tied with existing reinforcement using binding wire or welded complete as per site requirement and directions of engineer in charge. Then providing and fixing rebar required length and diameter with Sika anchor fix or Mungo, Fisher, Hilti. There are lots of chemicals are available for the chemical anchorage as written over here. Then providing and fixing of shear connectors of 16 mm dia tall steel up to 160 mm length with the given available chemicals which is written over there. And epoxy resin RCC member, including power drilling, cleaning of holes, insertion of epoxy, placing shear connector in position to ensure the bond as per the manufacturer recommendation, complete as per site requirement and the direction of engineer in charge. So these are the materials which we have suggested, and the way which we have suggested, they have to follow all these step by step. Now, epoxy bonding, a bonding primer. First, we have discussed that we removed the chip of the unsound and loose material from the column. Then the surface preparation by using, we have used this rust remover and all these taking care of rusting. Then the fixing of new reinforcement. And now the fourth step is epoxy bonding primer. So that we have to apply a epoxy bonding in between old concrete and new concrete bond. Providing and mixing or applying two component epoxy resin concrete bonding coat on prepared RCC surface as per manufacturer specification, including preparation of the surface by chipping and thoroughly cleaning of surface complete wherever required as per the direction of engineer in charge. And when we are going to apply that kind of some epoxy bonding primer, it comes with a pot life. Every bonding primer having some pot life, like it having a pot life of around half an hour. If whole process of this, if you are working, this whole process should be completed within the half hour. If it is extending from half an hour, then it will adversely affect, because up to half an hour, it is working as a bonding agent. And after half an hour, it will act as a debonding layer between old and new concrete. So for that, you have to be very precise that the manufacturer have given some pot life, you have to follow all the instruction regarding the pot life. Then the final one is jacketing with micro concrete, providing and fixing watertight centering and shuttering, including bolting, strutting, propping, etc., including removal of formwork from column, beam, etc., as per site's requirement. Then a non-shrink cementitious free flow micro concrete is used over there, and this they having the some product requirement over there, that is the compressive strength is greater than 60 newton per mm square, that is on 28 days according to ASTM C110799. Now, if we talk about these, this was the repair methodology which we have suggested for the repair of spalled concrete, and this is now we are further going for the repair of the efflorescence at ground level and sunken area. Ultimately, the efflorescence is because of the ingress of moisture into your concrete. So we have to stop the ingress of moisture. For that, the first step is surface preparation, then waterproofing coating, and then patch repair mortar if there is any local deamination of concrete. The first is surface preparation, that is same as which we have discussed for the micro concreting, that removal of loose material, chiseling with hammer up to 30 mm and all these things. Then waterproofing coating, we have to apply and apply the glass fiber reinforced arsenic modified cementitious coating, that is which the product which we have used is Sika Top Seal 107, and the detail is given over there, and the density which is written over there, and the compressive strength is around 20 newton per mm square, bond strength is 2 newton mm square approved by the portable water contact. Here, any material which we are using for this, if we are going to check the bond strength, there is a test, there is another NDT test which comes for this testing of bond, that is your pull off test. Then patch repair mortar, if there is a localized problem over there, there is some patches over there which you have to treat over there, then that can be using patch repair mortar. Supply and apply of epoxy resin based solvent free bond coat, then we will apply a pre-matched one component polymer modified cementitious patch repair mortar for a thickness of 40 mm only, or if it is required, then you can go for less also, but here the situation was according to situation we have suggested 40 mm or as per the direction by the engineer in charge. So the here you can see this is the detailed data sheet of this particular material which we have suggested. Now coming to the hairline cracks in the brick wall. If what is the hairline crack in the brick wall? If there are hairline crack, then we have to treat the hairline crack by first we have to cut the V groove of 3 mm wide and 3 mm deep so that the sealing of that crack is done easily. Then apply rust non-shrink repair mortar apply water-resistant white cement for finishing. So these are the material which we have used that for sealing the crack. The first, the material which we have used is Sika Crack Seal. And the detailed data sheet is provided over there. And the white cement which we have used for the surface finishing and smoothing is Sika Wall Decor. That is just only a your finishing material. And now coming to the major crack, if that was the cracks which we have discussed were minor cracks. And now we are going to discuss about the major crack, the repair of major cracks. The first one is packer drilling installation and finishing, grouting of the gaps, surface preparation, then drilling holes, then cleaning holes, fixing of packers, cutting of packers. These are the step-by-step procedures which are used for the repair of major cracks. First is chipping, that is same. We have to chip off the unsound weak concrete from the cover of reinforcement up to cover of reinforcement. Then supply shrinkage to free expanding polymer modified cementous free flow grout, that is Sika grout 214 is used over there. Then packers drilling, the packers which is known as nozzles also through which the your material is to be injected. Then fixing of packers, insert 12 mm dia and 50 to 75 mm long injection packers is cleaned holes with the structural grade epoxy adhesive like Sikadu 31 or equivalent. The injection, the material which we are going to inject, that is Sikadu 31. Then the cutting of the packers, which is written over there, the high shrinkage free flow, Sikadur 31 is used for the adhesive and the injection which we have, that is high strength epoxy grout, which is known as Sikadur 52, which is written over here. So these are the technical data sheet also provided with this, that what is the compressive strength, that is 55 Newton per mm square on 7 days only. You can see this is the quality of epoxy grouting, that within 7 days you can get the strength of 55 Newton per mm square. So, on conclusion, observing the damage condition of the outer 12 columns marked in the orange color in the plan requires full height repair, and 11 columns marked in yellow color in the plan requires repair jacking up to second floor only. Exposed concrete was found to be carbonated. The carbonate concrete should be provided with anti-carbonation coating if the spalling of the cover concrete has not started. Due to the effect of corrosion, the spalling was observed in these columns, so it is necessary to repair the structure so it will be unable to withstand against the combination of loads for which it is designed. The spalling of concrete from the column should be repaired with micro concrete. All the repair work required to be done should be carried out as per the methodology and sequence provided. So by this method, we conducted the whole building's NDT testing. And on behalf of all these tests, we suggested these repair methodology and how you can treat your building and how you can this particular building was treated. Now, there is another case study of a bridge. If I talk about this bridge that happens last year, it is a case study of a repair of pre-stress bridge over Ashwani Khad on Kufri Chal Kanda Ghat Road at RD 45/100. So this happens. What was the actual scenario over there? There were three main girders have been casted, but in the middle girder, due to breakdown of concrete pump, the work remains suspended for 4 hours. And if it is the work is suspended for 4 hours, which will lead to the formation of cold joint. But at that time, the proper treatment of cold joint was not done, and due to which the crack was developed at bottom flange diagonally in a length of 3 meters at the time of first stage of stressing. So filling the crack with what we have to do is, now this is the crack which we have observed is because of this cold joint formation, and because at that particular location your concrete was the cold joint is the weakest zone over there. And during the as I told you, that is a pre-stressed bridge, and at the time of first stage of pre-stressing, the crack develops. And now what we have to do is to fill this crack. So the crack was filled with high strength epoxy grouting, that is a low viscous epoxy grout, which we have discussed in previous lecture, that whatever the material which we have suggested or which we have to inject into a concrete should be a low viscous epoxy grout. The ultrasonic pulse velocity tests were conducted before and after the repair of the girder. The repair was taken taken at the site, but before repair, we have taken some test over there. We conducted some test. We recorded some values, and after test, we have recorded some values so that we can compare what is the is that gap is filled over there, and what is the present situation over the concrete. So this is the crack which is shown over there. This is the crack. This kind of crack was appeared at the site. And how this is a zoomed image over there because of some the department's reason. I am not able to show you the whole picture of that because whole picture of the bridge, because that is not allowed to take the complete picture. So this is the zoomed picture of that particular crack over there, and how, because how we can repair it is here. You can see we have installed the nozzles over there. And that nozzles were fixed with the help of this adhesive bond. That is maybe by using, you can fix them by using micro concrete or maybe by using Sikadur 31 adhesive. You can see this is the injections which were installed. And through these injections, these nozzles, the material is injected into the bridge structure. So these are the results. You can see there are the downstream side of the middle girder and upstream side of the middle girder. I can call it beam. So in that, you can see before treatment, the values is less than 3000, which is on your second column. You can see if we talk about the column number one, serial number, then the location in haunch, 60 centimeters from the center line of the beam. That is the location where the test was conducted. And the same test was conducted at that particular point before treatment and after treatment. Before treatment, the value was 2,762 meter per second. And after treatment, the value is gradually increased and it is 4,215. So it comes in the category of very good. So in remarks, you can see the quality of concrete is increased from poor to very good. In second case, you can see there is a 2,128 and the value is increased 4,651, which shows that the value is increased from poor to excellent. So these are the values on which is shown over there, and this satisfy that the crack which is appeared over there is completely filled up with the epoxy grouting. So what is the conclusion? The average relative strength of the concrete varies from 42 to 47 Newton per mm square, corresponding to the rebound hammer test. Because this test results I have not shown over here. We have conducted the rebound hammer test also. But our main aim was to fill this particular crack. So a rebound hammer have no relation with this crack. The general quality of concrete is improved after epoxy treatment in the range of very good to excellent. Since after the treatment, the quality of concrete is very good, it shows the absence of corrosion, honeycombing, cracks, voids, etc. at the location where the tests were conducted. So the conclusion is that the bridge is sustained and it is presently, it is still working and in good condition. Now, there is one very interesting case study regarding, there is a case study, strengthening of RCC columns below plinth beam at a military station, Bathinda, which was conducted recently by me, that during construction of garage shed, there was a gap left between the pedestal and plinth beam. And you can see that is not a, it is not a particular case of disintegration or deterioration with respect to time. This is a completely case of negligence of the workers working over there. So it was a challenge for us to fill this gap. You can see this is the image. From here, you can easily take it out that there are the gap between. You can see this is the gap over there. Pedestal is coming from bottom and there is a gap between pedestal and plinth beam. In both the pictures, it is clearly visible that there is only steel reinforcement over there. No concrete is in between your plinth beam and your pedestal. So Now, this is the challenge, how you can treat this, because we can't fix something material, some material, or you can grout the material inside, because grouting is done only on the cracks. So where here, what we have done is the size of the column, repair methodology, what we have suggested and which we have conducted, this particular project is completely done by me. And I have taken care of all these things. The size of the column from the foundation was enlarged by using micro concrete, that is of M60 grade. The shear connector should be provided of 8 mm at the rate of 350 mm staggered on the plinth beam. The thickness of the jacketing of micro concrete is 75 mm, or you can call it 3 inches. The jacketing should be done from top of the foundation level to the top of the plinth beam. The extra reinforcement of 10 mm is provided by chemical anchorage into the foundation. Jacketing is done up to the top of the plinth beam. So this is the repair methodology. How we can do is providing support scaffolding and surface preparation, then fixing or grouting of new reinforcement, then epoxy bonding primer, then jacketing with micro concrete. Here you can see the repair methodology which we have conducted. In first picture, you can see the new steel reinforcement is provided, which is provided by grouting the steel, new steel, into the by providing chemical anchorage into the foundation. And then the second image shows that the for jacketing we have provided the formwork over here so that we can increase the size of the particular column. Now here you can see the further process is going on, because it is a very tidy job over there, because we having it is not a straight column. We having the plinth beam in between, and we have to take care of that plinth beam also. So during this, you can see we have to provide a special formwork to support the micro concrete. And the second image which is showing is completely the formwork is completed. But for that, we have to doing this in a stages. In stages, first what we have to do is we have to surface preparation, which I have shown in your previous image. That surface preparation should be done. And after surface preparation, the steel is fixed over the site. And after the fixing of site, bonding primer is applied. And there is a pot life of bonding primer. As I have told you earlier on my previous slide, that we have to take care of bonding primer very carefully. That bonding primer, which we have used, the pot life was around 1.5 hours. So we having the 1.5 hour of time at the time of mixing of that bonding primer, and the whole process should be completed within 1.5 hour. So you can see this is the further process. And finally, after the completion of this work, what we have achieved is this. Now you can see the gap between the plinth beam and the pedestal is completely fixed by enlarging the size of the pedestal by using micro concrete jacketing. So this is this way you can we treated this, and we have treated these columns, and around 228 columns were there, which we have found that kind of defect in these columns below the foundation level. And we have treated all these columns successfully. And you can see this the grade of concrete which we have used, as I have told you, or we have discussed, that whenever we are going to treat such kind of treatment, we have to treat it with some higher grade or equal to grade. But here in case we have choose the higher grade, because the thickness which we are providing is very less, because if we are treating with same grade, we have to take care of thickness also. So we have used this micro concrete, and the thickness of only 3 inches, where that is 75 mm, we used M60 grade of concrete. The existing grade of parent concrete was of M30. So what is the conclusion over there? The repair work carried out at site is as per the specification and methodology given for the strengthening of the pedestal. Jacketing is done from top of the foundation level to the top of the plinth level. The bond between old and new concrete is intact. Jacketing is acting as a monolithic structure. The average relative strength of micro concrete jacketing varies from 30 to 46 Newton per mm square, corresponding to rebound hammer test and ultrasonic pulse velocity test after 14 days. we have conducted these tests just after 14 days, and we got the strength of 30 to 46 Newton per mm square. And we have also taken the UPV test on these columns, which I've seen, on by providing the probes on old one probe on the older concrete, one probe on the new concrete, so that we can check the bond between the old and new concrete is formed proper or not. And the values which we are given is in of excellent quality. The general quality of concrete is in the range of excellent, which is already written over there. So these are the some case studies which I have taken care. I have done all these practically by myself, and you can see all these repair methodology which I have suggested. So thank you so much. And I'm going to complete sum up this session over there. And if you want to ask some question or you having some query, you can ask.
MMU Mulana.
So we are starting with MMU Mulana.
It was a beautiful lecture. And the case studies presented are really useful for the in fact, in one of our labs, we are facing the problem of laminates.
Yes, ma'am.
I'll be sending some pictures of that particular lab to your library, and I would like to emphasize that laminates be controlled in that particular lab.
Ma'am, just a second. There is some problem with speakers. I'm not able to hear your voice over there.
Seismic upgradation of
Sorry for the interruption. There was some problem with the speakers over here, and I was not able to hear your voice over there.
Is it audible now?
Yeah, ma'am, please.
First of all, thanks for such a beautiful lecture. Second thing was that. Hello?
Yes, ma'am, please carry on, ma'am.
We have a lab in one of our workshops where we have arch type of roof, and we are facing waterproofing, you can say dampness problem right from beginning. And we have gone through many kind of waterproofing solutions over that. So perhaps those are not truly successful, especially near the joints where electrical fittings and those things are there. So can you suggest some repair mechanism to take care of that dampness?
Yes, ma'am, definitely. But actually, at very early when I started with my this lecture, I suggested that first we have to find out what is the root cause behind every problem, because we are getting this moisture from somewhere. So first of all, we have to take care is that dampness is because of rising dampness, or it may be coming from some, is there is any leakage over there, or what was the root cause behind that. And first of all, we have to stop that moisture from where we are getting. And then your what you have taken care of your roof, waterproofing treatment and whatever what measures you have taken will work effectively. Otherwise, if there it is inside a build, it is a, or your RCC structure, if it is a RCC structure, then the advanced repair methodology, that is for waterproofing, you can go for the crystallization process.
Okay, because the roof type is arch type, it has a slope, and the problem appears only during heavy rainy season. So there is perhaps no other root cause other than you can say accumulation of water during heavy rains.
Yes, ma'am.
The problem is then and there only.
Yeah, ma'am. Then this is the clear case of that is the seepage during the rainy seasons only. So then, ma'am, you have to provide some suitable waterproofing solution, that is injecting a waterproofing solution of crystallization process.
Mm-hmm. Though we have gone for nozzle kind of spraying of waterproofing material there. But truly speaking, this crystallization has not been tried. So with your guidance, we will try to look into
Definitely, if it is possible, then I will definitely visit your that particular site. And on behalf of that actual condition over there, I will suggest you the remedial measure over there.
We will get in touch with you through your mail ID shortly regarding the problem and situation.
Okay.
Thank you.
Engineering College, Sikar.
Sir, do you have any query and you want to ask some questions?
Yeah, no worries. But I'm thankful to you for your wonderful session on the whatever the civil engineering artifacts.
Yeah, sir.
And we got much insight into the civil engineering artifacts and the various kinds of tests. Actually, we got the generic knowledge on the civil engineering aspects, I think.
Okay, sir.
Thank you so much.
Welcome, sir. Shulini University. I think Shulini University is not connected. Dev Bhumi Polytechnic College.
No, sir. Thank you.
Welcome. Chitkara University. Chitkara University, you want to ask some question or you have any query?
No, sir. No questions.
Thank you. Yeah, Shulini University.
No questions, sir.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Okay. Thanks a lot.
Yes. Yes.
We can't stop the water coming. But can we clean the material?
Yes, definitely. Because efflorescence occurs because of the presence of salt. Generally, what happens, the brick which we have used, having salt content itself during the time of the construction of that casting of that particular bricks. If that brick having some salts over there, and whenever it is getting in touch with the moisture, the efflorescence will definitely come. But so, if it is already installed on your building, then it is difficult to remove that bricks. So the only option left out is to stop the ingress of moisture.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. So thank you so much for joining this repair and rehabilitation workshop with us. And we are thankful to all the colleges, those which are connected with us, and they have listened us very carefully. And one more thing that I want to share with you is that we are having a 2 days international conference in our institute, and which is on sustainable building materials and sustainable all the sustainable energies over there, building materials over here. So if you are willing to join over there, you can join today as well as tomorrow. It is a 2 days international conference which is holding in NITTR's auditorium. So it is my request, if you want to join or you can send some students, then we having a very good exposure over here. We have exhibition also, which is done by the experts of industries. They have shown their materials which are presently used, and they are very helpful to the students as well as the teachers of all the colleges. So it's my request, if you want to join, you can join today and tomorrow. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much for this wonderful session and this wonderful complete 1 week workshop. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm.